come, O Lord our God. Let us confess our sins to God and prepare ourselves that may worthy participate in this holy sacrifice. Well, it's the Sunday after Easter, and I was prepared for a little, but this, oh my gosh. I want to thank Allie here for being my acolyte. I told her whatever she knows how to do, she can do, and everything else I'll kind of fill in. And I want to thank Mike over there for manning the camera today. And also his wife who's there supporting him. Also there, yeah. When you hear the gospel today, you're going to hear about Mary Magdalene. And the disciples had gone out to the tomb, they saw that it was empty, and then they went back. They just weren't all that patient. And so they went back into Jerusalem, but Mary stays at the tomb. And because Mary stays at the tomb, she's the first one to actually see the resurrected Jesus. So last Sunday, a lot of people came to church. We had a beautiful liturgy, and you put your best foot forward, and you think maybe that's going to inspire some people, but every priest knows that the Sunday after Easter, for some reason, they call it Low Sunday. I don't know if it's just too much all packed into one, and then people get tired of God. I really don't know what it is, but they just don't come back on that following Sunday. I think they want to put Jesus back in the tomb or something, I don't know. But Mary stays at the tomb, and because she stays there, she sees the resurrected Jesus. You have stayed at the tomb. You weren't there just for the, look inside, see it's empty, and then went back to, the old ways. You stayed at the tomb. You came back today. And because you've come back today, you have that better chance of seeing the resurrected Jesus in your life. And so as we do gather today to continue that glorious message of the Easter resurrection, and because Jesus is the first fruit of the dead come back to life, we also have that same promise of new life because of our relationship with Jesus. So as we gather today on a little bit of a snow-covered day outside, we're New Englanders. That's not even an excuse. I'm not even going to consider that as an excuse. But we here are people of faith. We understand the joy and the promise of this day. And in that spirit, I ask you to please make an examination of conscience in preparation for Mass. Now recite the Confiteor together. I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I earnestly repent of all my wrongdoings, and am heartily sorry that I have offended you. Most merciful Father, have mercy on me, forgive me, and pardon me my sins. I resolve to amend my life, improve and sanctify it, that I may become worthy to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I beseech the Blessed Mother Mary, all the saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray to the Lord, our God, for me. May Almighty God have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting. May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and the remission of our sins. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and by his authority vested in me, I absolve you from your sins, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. O God, you will again renew us. Show us, O Lord, your mercy. Alleluia.
And grant us your salvation.
Alleluia. O Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our cry come to you.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Take away from us our iniquities, we beseech you, O Lord, that pure hearts may enter into the tabernacle of the Holy of Holies, through Christ our Lord. I waited for the Lord, who bent down and heard my cry, drew me out of the pit of destruction, out of the mud of the swamp, set my feet upon rock, steadied my steps. Alleluia. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you redeemed us for the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Grant we may benefit from the graces merited by this our Savior. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
The lesson for this morning's Holy Mass is taken from the Acts of the Apostles. Now many signs and wonders were done among the people through the apostles, and they were all together in Solomon's portico. None of the rest dared to join them, but the people held them in high esteem. Yet more than ever, believers were added to the Lord, great numbers of both men and women, so that they even carried out the sick into the streets and laid them on cots and mats, in order that Peter's shadow might fall on some of them as he came by. A great number of people would also gather from the towns around Jerusalem, bringing the sick and those tormented by unclean spirits, and they were all cured. Here ends the lesson as prescribed by the Church for this morning's Holy Mass.
Thanks be to God. Too costly in the eyes of the Lord is the death of his faithful. Alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia. I praise you, Lord, for you raised me up and did not let my enemies rejoice over me. Lord, you brought me up from Sheol. You kept me from going down to the pit. Almighty and eternal God, who cleansed the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal, cleanse my heart and my lips through your gracious mercy, that I may worthy proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthy proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John.
Glory to thee, O Lord.
And then the disciples returned home, but Mary stayed outside of the tomb weeping. And as she wept, she bent over into the tomb, and there she saw two angels in white sitting there, one at the head and one at the feet where the body of Jesus had once laid. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken my Lord, and I don't know where they have laid him." And when she said this, she turned around, she saw Jesus there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? What are you looking for?" And she thought it was a gardener. She said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you laid him, and I will take him." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned, and she said to him in Hebrew, "Rabbi," which means teacher. And Jesus said to her, "Stop holding on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers, and you tell them that I am going to my Father and to your Father, to my God and to your God." And Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord and what he had told me." By the words of this holy gospel, may our sins be forgiven. Gospel according to St. John. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Last week was Easter Sunday, and we heard about the empty tomb, but no one had yet seen the resurrected Jesus. We went through almost 2 hours of liturgy, and no one got to see the resurrected Jesus according to the story. Today, that all changes as we continue to read from John's Gospel about the mystery that is Easter. John told us last Sunday that Mary Magdalene had gone to the tomb, and then he chooses to emphasize while it was still dark. That may seem minor. The other three accounts from Matthew, Mark, and Luke, however, they all say that the empty tomb is discovered as dawn breaks. But John insists that Mary ventures out to the tomb while it is still dark. Now, this isn't so much an historical detail. We haven't found like an inconsistency in the Gospels, but that's not what he's concerned about. This is a theologically important point. Most every Sunday, we conclude Mass with John chapter 1, and therefore most every Sunday, we hear John say of Jesus, "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it." And this imagery of light overcoming darkness continues throughout his gospel, all the way to that 20th chapter. First chapter we hear about it, the 20th chapter, it's there again, and it's no accident that it's there throughout, and then it makes that glorious appearance at Easter. Mary goes out to the tomb in the actual darkness before dawn, and she's there to grieve. But there's also the emotional, spiritual darkness inside her. We hear twice today that Mary is crying. She peers into the empty tomb, and the angels in there, they ask a kind of silly question, because, you know, angels don't have to deal with the ideas that humans have to deal with, of loss and of sickness and being scared of death. They just live up in the presence of God. And so they ask Mary the silly question, "Why are you weeping?" They just don't get it. She turns around and sees a man that she thought to be a gardener. And again, we hear that same question. "Why are you weeping?" They just don't understand what it means. And then Mary's on the brink of an emotional collapse because she was one of the few faithful followers that had actually followed Jesus all the way to the cross and to his execution. She comes back to the tomb in the darkness before dawn because she knows the reality of his death is so real that she's there to grieve beside his dead body. There is no resurrection hope at that point. And now she imagines that his enemies had even desecrated the body of Jesus, taking it out of the tomb, and who knows what they've done to it. And she thinks that the body has been stolen, and it's no wonder that she's crying. But dawn is about to break. Light is about to overcome darkness. And just as has been promised in John chapter 1, in John chapter 20, there is still that glimmer, that light is about to appear. Mary had gone to the tomb in the darkness before dawn, but now dawn is about to begin. Light is reappearing. And in that new light, the resurrected, the transformed Jesus, a Jesus that she can't recognize by sight, he simply calls out her name. The familiarity of that voice crashes through all of Mary's reservations, all of her fears, all of her sadness, and in a moment, in an instant, she recognizes Jesus. Again, not by seeing him with her eyes, but at the level of relationship. Jesus is not going to be found by us trying to look around and see him here or there or wherever. Jesus is going to be found in relationship when he calls out our name and we recognize his voice. And that will help us to believe in the unbelievable. And that's what's going to help us to believe that so many other people, they just can't do it. We can because of relationship. And no matter what our personal darkness may be, loss, sickness, fear, maybe worried about a job, whatever our personal darkness may be, to assure us of his light when he calls out our names, that's the mystery of Easter. That's what we celebrate today. The prophet Isaiah, hundreds of years before any of this happened, had a touching passage which God calls out to his people, I have called you by your name, and you are mine. And you know, that's a transitional stage for Israel. They're going from a very monarchical God who sits enthroned and away from everybody, and he's kind of to be feared. And Isaiah is starting to get this glimmer of a personal God who cares about each and every one of us. Isaiah is beginning to see that God is not so much about power, that God is more about love and relationship with us. And this is what we're meant to hear again when Jesus simply says Mary's name. Relationship is the key to understanding Easter. It's what allows us to recognize Jesus, no matter how many other things in the world are complicating it. If we have that relationship, when he calls out our name, Easter is real. Let me backtrack for just one moment. Mary has remained at the tomb after Peter, the beloved disciple, had already returned to Jerusalem, like I mentioned at the beginning of Mass. She appears inside, and there are two angels seated there. And there's a burial bench, like probably just a stone slab, and she looks in, and there's an angel here, and there's an angel there, and just the cloths, the burial cloths in between. And again, this is a unique detail of John's gospel. It's not in the other ones, and its importance, again, is not historical, it's theological. From the grave, it's a stone's throw up to the Jerusalem temple. And so inside the Holy of Holies of the Jerusalem temple, there stood two massive cherubim statues, fancy, powerful angels. One wing of one angel would touch the wall of the Holy of Holies. The other wing of the other angel would touch the other wall. And then their two wings would meet over the sea, the throne of mercy. And it was believed that there is where heaven and earth touched, where God resided on earth. And John is telling us that the presence of God is no longer in that building. He is no longer in the temple. He is not between two statues of angels. God's presence among us is now in the risen Christ, whose body once lay where those two angels were seated at either end of that burial slab. He is now where heaven and earth touch. The resurrected Jesus is now our temple. You know, a lot of people, because it's an out-of-character story, remember the story of Jesus getting angry in the temple courtyard and overturning the tables and the money changers and declaring, "Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." The other three Gospels, all places at the very end of Jesus' life. But again, John, unique, he takes it and he puts it at the very beginning of Jesus' ministry. And at this point, he was challenged by the authorities. They demanded of him, "You provide us, how do we know that God has given you this authority to do these things?" And Jesus gave an answer at the beginning of the gospel that would not be fulfilled until the very end, just as was with that theme of light. Jesus answers them by saying, "You destroyed this temple, and in 3 days, I will raise it up." The temple has moved from a place built by human hands to Jesus, who was raised by God the Father on that third day. We approach this temple not by walking through doors of any building. We need to be able to recognize Jesus' voice, its relationship. We find Jesus in that relationship when he calls out Mary to Mary Magdalene, when he calls out each of our names. It doesn't matter where we go. Relationship is the one that makes God possible for us. That things have changed this dramatically is made clear in John's gospel when the resurrected Jesus tells Mary, who is holding on to his feet, holding on for dear life, "Do not hold on to me because because I have not yet ascended to the Father. Mary wants to return to the old Jesus, to the old way things were. But everything has changed because of Easter. Everything except relationship. Mary couldn't recognize Jesus with her eyes when she first saw him, and she wanted to hold on to him, just like she once did before. But darkness was defeated. Light had triumphed. Relationship brought joy back into her life, and that relationship was not the same as the one that it had been. It changed, but it was still relationship. And then an amazing thing happens. Jesus sends Mary to the other apostles so that she tells them about Easter. At that moment, she becomes what is known as the apostle to the apostles. I have seen the Lord, she proclaims to them. And I wonder if that simple phrase that so many churches throughout the world are reading today, I wonder if that phrase, I have seen the Lord, has anything to do with tomorrow being declared the World Day of Prayer for women's ordination. Everything has changed except relationship because of Easter. Maybe we should think more about what this change means, about letting go of old forms and embracing the new, so that relationship is always what is emphasized. Why would anybody push somebody away from Jesus? So we need to bring them as close as we possibly can to Jesus, however we can do that, but we can't push people away. And I think we need to think about the fact that everything changes with Easter. Jesus is resurrected, and he is all around us. It's just such a shame that so many more people can't see him. But we have to build a relationship that is able to hear him calling our name, always and everywhere. And may that be helped by what we do here through church and through liturgy. And for this we pray in Christ's most holy of names. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty Lord, as we gather before your altar on this, the first Sunday after Easter, and we continue to celebrate your resurrection and the promise of our own, we offer prayers in memory of Henry Petrosky, who died on April 1st of 1999, as offered by daughter Marge Sanderson. We offer prayers for Ted Thomas, 85 years old, having back surgery for 5 herniated discs, as offered by Don and Ellen Skrosky. We also offer our prayers for John Otoska, a high school friend of Ellen Skrosky, who is now battling leukemia, as offered by Ellen. We offer our prayers in memory of Joseph and Ted Rodak, who died in 1974 and 1986, as offered by daughter Linda. We offer prayers for Wanda Dufault. Yesterday, April 2nd, was the 5th anniversary of her death, as offered by Don and Ellen Skrosky. We offer prayers for Henry Wisniewski on the 13th anniversary of his death, April 2nd, as offered by his daughter, Sharon Calvo. We offer prayers for the soul of Daisy Benjamin, who passed away 1 year ago on April 1st, as offered by her loving family. We offer prayers for Louise Bohalski as she recovers at the Buckley Health Center in Greenfield, as offered by her sisters of the Adoration Society. We also continue to offer our prayers for those battling cancer. Doug Robinson by daughter Jenny Whitman and Karen Herzig, Tom Neidel by Teresa Belial, Meg Connors by Ellen and Don Skrosky, Marie Loven and Carl Dickinson by Joe and Peg Kostchuk, Brandy Clements by her grandmother Dottie Baronis, also fathers Ray Trada, Jan Bielcheck, and Maurice Lazelle as offered by myself, and also for Frank Skrosky, diagnosed with a neurological disease, is offered by his twin brother Don, the Skrosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families. Are there any specific intentions that you would like to offer from the congregation? For all of these prayers, Lord, including those that we bring before you in the privacy of our thoughts, and also we ask you to bless each and every one of us here gathered, and to bless those from our parish who are unable to be with us here today, and those of our parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us, for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, I will present my thank offerings before you, for you have delivered me from death and my feet from stumbling, that I may walk before God in the light of his life. Alleluia. We receive from your most sacred hands, O most gracious Father, the sacramental bread of the same faith and trust as with the apostles and disciples of your Son and our Savior, when he said to them, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. The bread that is given for the life of the world is my flesh. O God, who did do us with great dignity and worthiness, through Jesus Christ, who is wonderfully and noble, uplifted, and sanctified, grant me the name of God. God, the Father Almighty.
praise the Lord his name, to our benefit and
that of the whole church. Amen. Lord our God, accept the offerings of we, your rejoicing church, which you have enlivened us with today, and grant us the gift of perpetual gladness, for you have given us cause for great joy. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God. Throughout all ages of ages,
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is worthy and just to do.
Father, all-powerful and ever-living God, we do well always and everywhere to give you thanks through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, especially at this time when he became our paschal sacrifice. He is the true Lamb who took away the sins of the world. Through his death he conquered death for us, and by his wondrous resurrection he restored eternal life. Therefore the angels and archangels, with all the saints and the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly.
Lord God, heaven and earth are full of majesty of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
We therefore, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, imploring you to defend and guide her throughout the world, together with her priests and all true believers of the holy faith. Remember, O Lord, your servants and your handmaidens. And of all present in this congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule and fatherly love, wholeheartedly this day, we unite in spirit with all of those, beginning with the most blessed Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise with apostles and with all the innumerable hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life and his most precious blood, just as they believe, profess, and united with you through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people, and afterwards foretold and given out to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. The bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." And afterwards, in the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all of those whom he loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. In the world you will face persecution, but take courage. I have conquered the world. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. For their sakes, I sanctify myself, so that they also may be sanctified in truth, that they all may be one. As you, Father, are in me, and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me, I in them, and you in me, that they may become completely one. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. After these other words of the archpriestly prayer and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, all of you take and eat of this, for this is my body. In like manner after supper, taking also this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again giving thanks to you, he blessed it and gave it to his disciples, saying, all of you take and drink of this, for this is the chalice of my blood, of the new and eternal testament, the mystery of faith, which for you and for many shall be shed for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you shall do these things, do them in remembrance of me. Wherefore, mindful, Lord, we your servants, as also your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as also his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, we receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of eternal salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance as from him, who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls the saving remedy. We humbly beseech you, Almighty God, command that our prayers be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar before the countenance of your divine majesty. That as many of us as should receive this altar of the most sacred body and blood of your Son may be filled with every blessing and grace through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be mindful also, Lord, of your servants and handmaidens, all who have gone before us with the sign of faith, and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, O Lord, as also to those who have died in Christ, grant everlasting life, and to those who during life strayed from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their sufferings, we beseech you, in the name of Christ our Lord and your beloved Son. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles, martyrs, and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name's sake, whose hearts are always open to justice and mercy, and whose lives, patterned after the divine master, merited eternal bliss. Number us, O Lord, in their company, with confidence we ask you, not because of our merits, but that you bestow forgiveness through Christ our Lord, by whom, O Lord, these gifts you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and bestow upon us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, is to you, God the Father Almighty, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and all glory. Throughout all ages of ages.
Amen.
Let us pray, admonished by salutary precepts, and following divine institution, we may hold to say. you, O Lord, from all evil, past, present, and future. And when you deem it necessary to test us, grant us the same serenity of spirit which you bestowed on the mother of our Lord Jesus Christ, the blessed apostles, martyrs, and all of those who resolutely marched under the banner of our Savior, that being supported by your help, may always be free from sin and secure from all despair. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, ever one God.
Throughout all ages of ages,
amen.
May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
May the union of your divine spirit with humanity in Jesus Christ be to our sanctification and life everlasting. Amen. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, grant us peace. O Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, my peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not upon our sins, but upon the faith of your church, and grant your peace and unity according to your will, who lives and reigns, God, world without end. Amen. O Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, who according to the will of the Father, through the cooperation of the Holy Spirit, has by your death revived the world, deliver me by this most sacred body and blood from all my iniquities and from every evil, and grant that I may always fulfill your holy will, who lives and reigns for all ages. Amen. Partaking of your body, O Lord Jesus Christ, which I, all unworthy, dare to receive, may not serve as a judgment, but through your mercy may become a defense of my soul and body and a desired remedy. May the sacramental union with you, Jesus Christ, my Master and Savior, awaken in me living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. May it make me a willing and zealous servant toward fulfilling God's purpose on earth, and may it at last unite me entirely with you, O Christ and God, in eternity. Grant this who lives and reigns with God the Father, the unity of the Holy Spirit, world without end. Amen. I will take the heavenly bread, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ preserve my soul unto life everlasting. Amen. What shall I return unto the Lord for all the graces that he has rendered unto me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ preserve my soul unto life everlasting. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Peace and blessings from God, the Father, the Spirit, and the Son, and forevermore. Amen. Body and blood of Christ. 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 Body and the blood of Christ. The 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 body and the blood of Christ. 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 The 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 body and the blood of Christ. Body and the blood of Christ. The body and the blood of Christ.
Amen.
Then you shall know that I am the Lord, when I open your graves and have you rise from them, O my people. Alleluia. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, to you belong the keys of life and of death by the will of the Holy Father. Preserve us through these holy mysteries of the Mass, that our redemption may be assured and our doubts relieved. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Sacrifice is offered. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia.
May the tribute of our worship be pleasing to you, O Holy Trinity, and grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, have offered up in the sight of your majesty be acceptable unto you, and through your mercy be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
May the Almighty and merciful God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. The beginning of the Holy Gospel according to St. John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was light, and the light was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light which enlightens everyone is coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, or the will of flesh, or the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh, and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of the Father's only Son, full of grace and of truth.
Thanks be to God.